open for nominations for your chair.
I nominate Charles Putnam.
Sorry, Charlie. You okay with that, Charlie?
I'm okay with it.
Okay.
There may be other nominations.
Anybody else? There's none. So I guess we can cast one ballot for Charlie, and congratulations.
Does someone want a second for nomination?
Oh, someone seconded? Okay, sorry.
Could be embarrassing, not that.
You'll need a knife, Charlie, if you can't cut this over now.
Yeah.
So, nobody has a key to this place, right?
No.
I will stay. Okay, so.
What business do we have tonight?
Election chair, but I don't know. I was just told that.
Do you want to elect a vice chair?
Oh, do you have a vice chair? I'm sorry, new at this.
I mean, there is, you can elect a vice chair if you want.
It's good to have somebody.
It's good to someone run the meeting.
Our vice chair died a long time ago. It was Bruce O'Neil.
Oh.
Bruce O'Neil. No, Bruce, I'm sorry, Moose. When he passed, we never re-elected one.
It might be a good idea, just in case Charlie's not available for a meeting.
Before we go any further with the questions, I got some questions that gotta go to the selectmen.
Come on. All right.
I think you knew someone were coming. Was there an oversight with Joe Coway not being reappointed?
Mr. Coway expressed himself that he was thinking of not rerunning or being reappointed. And so Suzanne took that as that he was ready to go, and so that's what happened. Whether or not it was an interpretation correctly or not, I don't know.
Well, just a little history. You know, the guy's been on the board since the day of inception, and he's been here longer than some people are of age that are at this table. You know, I think that showed a total lack of respect. I mean, the guy lives across the street. You know, somebody could have walked over and at least asked him to come over and chat.
Mm-hmm. He had a conversation with Suzanne. So whether or not it was like, I would suggest that you bring it to the Board of Selectmen and let it come up in our meeting, why that happened. Because I don't really have the whole history, because it happened during the election time. So I don't know a whole lot about it, except that I know that he had a conversation with her, and he also expressed his desire possibly to step down. That's all I know. But if you want more answers, feel free to come to the Board of Selectmen's office. A meeting.
That's not the information that I'm getting. You know, I have asked, and it's close, but not as accurate as what I was told. Now, I don't know what's right, so that's why I wanted to confront. I was hoping you all three were going to be here.
All three of us were going to be here?
Yeah, I was hoping.
Why would we?
Well, I don't know, why not? I mean, we've never had a shake-up on the board like this has been.
Oh, for that reason? I don't know.
Okay.
I'm a newbie here. I'm sorry, I don't know the answers. I just know what I read a document, and that's what I just explained
okay.
to you. And more answers could come at a select board's meeting or speak with Suzanne. I'm just here, I was just here because Suzanne is not able to come in. Is that the only question you had for me?
I'll accept that answer right now. Thank
okay.
you.
You're welcome.
Is there other, so we're on the question of whether or not to have a vice chair. Are there other thoughts about whether it's helpful to have one, whether we want to have one?
I think, you know, either way it's fine with me.
And what did the ZBA do after the previous vice chair died? It only met if Joe could meet?
Joe kind of met. Joe set up the meetings. Mm-hmm. Whoever the people were, I think he got in touch with Sarah. A lot of the dates, you know, were picked by based, you know,
based
then we got notified
as
we have a meeting on this date.
Are there time limits to, like, when we get an appeal or get a special exception appeal or a variance petition, do we have time limits that we have to be able to respond in?
Yeah, there are.
I mean, I think, Charlie, one of the reasons why I was interested in getting on the ZBA a year ago was that, and you know, no offense to Sonny here, is a very valuable and longstanding member is, I was saying in a couple of meetings, I thought, and one of my impressions, with all due respect to Joe, is that we need a lot more process in these meetings, especially if something goes up on appeal. So I guess the short answer to your question is, I don't know how well timelines are followed in the past.
Because one of the reasons for having a vice chair is if the chair were traveling, you know, on some kind of an extended trip, or was ill, you would want somebody that could convene the board and could act if there were notices that needed to be published and so forth. I confess, I read the handbook more than a month ago, and I'll have to reread it now a couple of times, but it strikes me that it might be helpful to have a vice chair so that the statutory requirements can be followed. And so that would, it's just a thought. Is there someone who either wants to be vice chair or is willing to nominate a vice chair?
Charlie, I would be happy to be that vice chair, but if someone else wants to be vice chair, or I have no, you know, but I'd be happy to be vice chair.
Who are the five delegates that are on the board?
So it's you, Charlie, Deanna, John, and Andrea.
Those are the five delegates?
Mm-hmm. Those two are the alternates.
I thought I saw one other name.
Who?
I'm trying to think.
Oh.
I didn't think so. I only saw an email from Andrea saying that she couldn't attend.
Right.
I thought there were five names, but I'm not 100% sure.
Well,
and two alternates.
Yeah, I could be wrong.
So no. I thought I read, but I thought it was seven altogether. But
are you a member? Are you?
No.
No. Are you a voting member?
No,
no,
I'm
you're
not.
Just saying,
no.
Okay.
And I think it would stand to reason that it would be an odd number.
So I have the appointment letter here.
We've done it with three.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's Andrea, Sunny, John, Charles, and Deanna.
So that's five, and then
two alternates.
Okay. And then your ex officio on the select board. Is it a voting member?
No,
no,
it's not.
Never had one.
No.
Okay.
Okay. I guess we just did it because we had to get election for the chair.
Yeah, you said
okay.
And John, are you ex officio from planning board or you're a member?
I'm a member.
You're a member, okay.
You still on the planning board?
I am. Technically, they haven't.
That's not allowed. He can't be a voting member. By the rules set up.
You can't be a voting member for planning board and the...
Correct.
Okay, that would make sense.
Well, you can't have them both. I mean, that could work for or against the...
Would you see that? Is that news
right
to me?
Right here. It's in the state guidelines.
In the state guidelines. Because one of the things, going way back, Sonny, to when I was on planning board, one of the things that I thought was a weakness in our planning process was that the ZBA acted without any input from the planning board. And I understand the need to avoid a conflict of interest.
Well, they recommend that a representative be here, but they call it a land board.
Yeah.
You know, instead of the planning board. It's in here. Because this actually come off of
Is that a statement?
Don't get me wrong, Charlie, he did. He brought a lot of stuff from the planning board. Two. And I think you spoke pretty well on this last one.
It would make a difference. difference, again, in terms of having a vice chair, would make a difference if John was somehow conflicted out, but let me just take a quick look at the statutes.
What I've been doing, by the way, in the planning board is if something comes in, looks like it's going to be going in front of the ZBA, I completely abstain.
Okay.
And don't, on the record, and don't even ask any questions, so. And I've just done that over abundance of caution.
And you abstain on the planning board or on the ZBA?
When things are coming from the ZBA, sorry, the planning board, that look like they're going to, might go for the ZBA, I've abstained from any discussion, let alone voting. You think it's more?
Well, so I just looked up the ZBA handbook that's put out by the state, and RSA 673:7 stipulates that appointed or elected planning board members in towns may also serve on any other municipal board or commission. So I think it is legal for him to serve.
Be a voting member?
Yeah, may serve.
See, I'm looking at that.
Although it is saying that two members of the planning board would not be allowed.
Except that no more, yeah, 673:71, except that no more than one member of the planning board shall serve on a conservation commission or the local land use board.
That's seven.
Well, yeah, 673:7, Roman 1. So we must, ZBA must be another one of the local land use boards. So I guess that would not bar John Sonny. Are you looking at the New Hampshire Municipal Association guidelines or?
This board is, I gotta find the cover sheet. This is the chapter on organization.
Okay. Where are you looking at that says that the planning board member can't be a... Let's see if I can get there too. I was looking at that document.
He was looking, I think, at 673:6.
There is a statute that I've seen that talks about, say, select board members being limited from membership on certain other boards, but...
Yeah, it could be on the budget committee and be a selectman because we already have an ex officio. So that would be two votes, technically.
Yeah, I'm not seeing... let's go to New Hampshire. You know, it's one of those things I've heard said over the years, Sonny. I know you're not making it up, but I'd like to confirm it.
In 673:6(5), it says an alternate member of a local land use board may participate. Is this the one that you were referring to?
Maybe it is the one.
In meetings of the board as a non-voting member pursuant to the rules. But I think if it might be in reference to a member in addition to the member already on the board?
I think that's what it is also.
Would you see it?
So under 673:6,
six, five, okay.
But I think that means that applies to the second member of the can participate, but not.
I think that makes sense. So in conjunction with the other statute, they wouldn't want two voting members on the planning board, on the zoning board, but there could be one under, so.
Why don't we do this? Cindy, why don't you and I go back to the drawing boards and see if we can dig up whatever it was that we found in the OSI manual that talks about membership? I know I have a copy of the OSI manual somewhere here looking around on my hard drive, but I'm not going to find it tonight.
John, I swear I read that word for word that said you couldn't vote. As a non-voting member.
I've heard something like that said, but it looks to me like 673.7 is pretty clear.
Although what's odd about that, Sonny, is that there's been a number of attorneys appearing in front of the board that never raised that issue. You know, when I've been on the CPA, they've never said that. I personally think the only way it gets to be an issue is that if I voted one way on the zoning board or the planning board, and then, I mean, I think if it took to the planning board and came here, it would be potentially an issue, I think. Maybe. I don't know if it would be. That's the only potential issue. I've always wanted to err on the side of caution on the one or two cases that I think have going to come up, and I've abstained entirely. But I've never understood the law to say explicitly that you can't be on both.
Well, if I'm wrong, I will apologize.
There's no reason to apologize. It's open and free discussion is encouraged.
And I think we're all going to be on a journey of learning here about the planning process. So. And with that in mind, why don't we plan to have another meeting, if we could? I'd like to have a meeting to just go through the process and talk about the process, outline the process. Is my understanding, Sarah, is that we don't have formal rules of procedure? We've never adopted?
Not that I've seen.
Do we have an application form?
There is an application form, yes.
Could I have a copy of the application?
I actually have it here. We're in the process of trying to revise it because we want to put it online.
One of the things that the OSI manual did recommend is that we have rules of procedure that clearly outline what people file and how we run our meetings and so forth. They have sample procedural rules. And what I would propose is that we get together and look at a set of those rules so that we have a good understanding as a board when we get our first. We don't have any pending.
There's nothing pending, and I have not heard about anything, any potential applicants.
Charlie, the only time I can tell you it gets rough is when an applicant comes in and they got a big dollar lawyer with them.
Yep.
That's when it gets, you know, I think probably one of the toughest guys was Malcolm McNeil.
Yep. I've been there.
And,
oh, whoa.
Actually, though, he wasn't that bad. I got to understand him real well with the condo project and how he's thought. So the next time we met, I was prepared for him.
What's generally on Tuesday evenings an okay time to meet?
Yes.
Yeah.
For me, it depends because we have planning the second Tuesday, or the first Tuesday, and I have library trustees planning is the first Tuesday, library is the second Tuesday. So I can do it, but I can only do it the third and fourth Tuesdays.
Come on, you can do two at once.
I have them, and it's a lot.
Hey, just like this.
Luckily for the trustee me, I don't have to do anything except talk. But.
Well, and I'm thinking our obligation under 91A for if we just have a workshop meeting would be to have minutes that say we met.
Yeah.
We had a workshop meeting to discuss procedural rules. End of story.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
The meeting would be open to the public. People could come and observe. But other than, I think we, after we had workshopped the set of procedural rules, I think we may have to hold a public hearing on the rules before we can adopt them. And then that would be fully noticed under 91A and whatever applicable zoning rules there are. So if we did it, although it sounds like you've been with the board for a long time, Sarah, so.
If we're doing procedure, I think it's probably good that I was here because I'm sort of the conduit for the applications from Caroline to the board.
Okay.
So.
But have it at a time when you can attend.
Yeah, and I apologize for.
It's all good. So we could do it on the third or fourth Tuesday. How is Wednesday?
I can't ever do Wednesdays.
Can't ever do Wednesday. How is Monday?
Where are you going to go Monday?
You can't do it in here.
There's selectmen here every Monday.
Oh, you can't do Monday, okay. How's Thursday?
Thursday's hit of us because I'm on the commission. We meet on Thursdays.
If we needed to meet on a Wednesday, I could adjust my schedule.
We'll try to work around your schedule, Sarah, that's okay.
You've got two Tuesdays open in the month.
Looks like we have two Tuesdays open in the month. We're hoping that we are going to use more than one. All right.
I would say next month, there's a little bit of, let's see. So next month I can meet on the 26th. That's the only Tuesday I have free.
And I'll be out of state then.
Okay.
You could have your meeting in the planning board room, couldn't you, on a Monday night if you wanted to.
We could do it at the library. We have a conference room that would be plenty of room for everybody at the library.
As long as it's posted location.
As long as we posted it, yeah.
Yeah, because the compound is meeting there tonight, so I think.
You really want to have one public, Charlie?
Pardon?
You really want to have it public?
We're legally obligated to have public meetings.
Well, the reason I'm saying that is, I mean, there's a lot of new people, and I don't know how you prepare them for the SOB that might come in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to be nice. I'm really trying. And it's going to happen.
It will happen, sooner or later. But basically, under RSA 91A, whenever a quorum of this body meets, it is a public meeting. The point is well taken. As we kind of talk through what the procedures are and what some of the things are that can go wrong, we all have the opportunity to embarrass ourselves. But I'll take the blame.
Okay, I think that the important thing is when an applicant comes in, that they're told what the zoning board does. Because the zoning board is not here to grant variances. It's to hear appeals.
Well, it was,
and what's the appeals heard? Administrative decisions, requests for variance, special exceptions.
And I was going to say, one of the three jobs that the board has is to consider requests for variances, petitions for variance. Yeah.
Yes.
Where did you find the planning board will also waiver a lot of those items? I've seen that in the past that should come, but don't come.
Mm-hmm. They'll waive the application of a rule?
Yeah, they've done some. I haven't seen it.
There are a lot of waivers. I think there is a big issue coming up down the pipe, which is, may or may not come, but one of the routes was to come this way, which is whether Shady Lane should be approved as a town road. That's one I completely abstained from. To summarize the result was that the applicant came and was granted by the planning board either the right to pave the road at the applicant's own expense, or to come in front of the ZBA and seek that road, what I think is a Class 6 road, be upgraded and approved as a town road. And there was a big turnout for that, and I think that is something that's definitely coming down the pike.
I'm not sure what's happening with that.
What's that?
I'm not sure what's happening with that.
Okay.
How can the planning board override the major body of the town when we close the road?
I abstain from that. I'm not going to wade into that. It's not officially before us, but I'm just saying.
Don't you wonder why I asked him that maybe some things shouldn't always be.
And I'm belatedly responding to Charlie's inquiry as to what may be coming down the pike. I think that is a very big issue coming down the pike, or could be coming down the pike.
So one of the things, as we talk in terms of what our procedure should be and how we work with applicants, we will need to keep it general and kind of hypothetical. We can't prejudge matters that may come before the zoning board. But I think there's a way that we can, there is a draft set of procedural rules, and maybe Sarah and I can look at that together.
I think in the handbook they have that, yeah.
And we can look at that together.
Another thing to consider is, should we have a form to fill out so that if there's an appeal of a decision, it goes to the lawyer, it comes back to us, or if it goes to the lawyer, that they can see exactly how we voted, each member. And it also gives us structure.
How each member voted is recorded in the minutes?
Yeah, but not for every individual item, right? We don't say, because I was on a board before, and we would say, okay, how do you vote on, granted a variance would be, would and would not be contrary to the public interest. You know, what you voted on
I agree with you 100% on that.
Boom. And then the second one, the spirit of the ordinance would or would not be observed. And then we would all give our answer. You know, and then we would write them down and pass it down to the recording secretary. And it would be filed with that particular case. And I would think it would educate the public, okay, the applicant. Okay, everything is transparent, because I'm here for transparency. Mm-hmm. And also structure.
Sarah, in your notes, did you do a roll call for every part of the application, or was there a single vote, you know, kind of up or down on the petition?
No, so when the final vote is recorded, every member's vote plus their reasoning or any comment they want to add is recorded in there.
You don't actually have to have a comment, though. You can just say,
you don't have to, no.
They may very well ask you for a comment. So if you say no to something, the applicant's probably going to want to know why you said no.
But you can say, as a board member, you can say, I'd rather not say.
You may need to give them a reason, because you just rejected them for no reason. Well, where I found that out to be very difficult is when the lawyers come in. Because the first thing he'll ask the chairman, on your vote, I would like your members to give their reasons along with their vote.
Yeah.
So he's going to use that information to go to Superior Court.
Although, my understanding was that in some towns, the ZBA provides a written decision.
Yes.
That contains a list of reasons so that you don't have to make up your list of reasons on the fly in public, or is that?
We published a notice of decision that has that records the vote as well.
You know, I think the hard part really is for us is we get a regular citizen, i.e. this guy comes in and wants to do something, and then we got this guy coming in with his lawyer. Well, this poor guy's stumbling, trying like hell. This guy is coming in with 2 6-guns loaded. You know, I mean, I think you need to extend yourself to this guy, but you want to be careful what you do with this guy.
Yeah, I've seen cases that the lawyer was totally wrong and the zoning board was 100% right. But, well, if you don't have a fact sheet, you know, how you voted, then it makes it very difficult, because it goes to the judge, and the judge wants to see if where was the mistake. And if the zoning board made an honest mistake, then he makes a recommendation. I looked at this case. It should go back to the zoning board, and this this is the things that I found, and I strongly recommend that you look at.
Were you folks always here when that condo project went up, was trying to go up behind Market Basket?
I lived in town.
Yeah, and you remember that? That was the one that really tested us.
Oh, yeah.
Because after we said no, he come back for an appeal. The lawyers and applicant come back again. And he admits, I had nothing new. So based on that, how are you going to make a decision to change your original decision? Nothing's going to change your mind. And what it was that was his next step to go to Superior Court. The judge ruled that we were wrong. Not the Zoning Board of Adjustment so much as the way the zoning laws were written, we should have allowed them. I don't know how much money was spent, but there was a fair amount of money on legal fees spent. Now, just so you're aware, Charlie, Joe actually hired an attorney to represent us at that last meeting that we had with them.
Uh-huh.
It was a guy out of, right here in Dover, right across the... And he was here. There was an intermission going, and we actually went private with him. And he told us the stuff that we were doing good and bad on, and just continued from there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of the things, I guess it's, I'm building a list of questions that we've got, so how do we document our decisions, and how do we share the reasoning for our decisions with the applicants and the public is one of the questions that I'll go back and look at the manual on.
That may be in the manual, tell you that, you know.
Yep, and the other, one of my questions is, and you maybe forget, Sonny, I'm sorry. I'm getting too old. Documenting, when and how can we go into non-public session? Because on planning board, there were times that we would go into non-public session for
you guys would close the public meeting.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll have to take a look at 91A, because I thought that 91A did protect deliberative sessions of public bodies, but let me check. Because it's one of the things that your point is well taken, as the board is working through its process of deciding. We may make unintended misstatements of fact or law that we would correct by the time we got to a final decision, but you'd hate to have people, you know, taking advantage of imperfections in, you know, people's manner of speaking as they work through a problem to attack the ultimate decision. So let me check on that. Are there other questions that we have that you've noticed either from experience or that you've been worried about coming into the as members of the ZBA?
Yes, it's important that everybody study the zoning ordinance. And do not assume that you read one section that you're over. Because a lot of times the zoning ordinance refers you to a second section. The second section refers you to the third section. And then there's some terms that you have to go to, you know, to the glossary to study. You know, that's really common on every regulatory compliance rules. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I feel that the zoning ordinance is written well, you know, from my, you know, experience with government rules and regulations. Mm-hmm.
There are times when it's yeah. All right. Do we want to try to set a time to get together? Let's take a look at our calendars. Sarah, if we could take advantage of your kind offer to meet at the library, would Monday, June 4th?
Yeah, I think that is fine. I don't think we have anything going on. Alternately,
29th?
Of May?
Yeah. Is Tuesdays better than Mondays, or?
Dylan's fine with me.
Memorial weekend, that's a hard weekend.
Okay.
Okay. So the 29th is right after Memorial Day?
Memorial Day is traditionally, it's Monday, the 28th.
28th.
Yes.
The 30th, traditionally, so.
Yeah, Monday the 4th is fine.
Monday the 4th, and it is, what's better for the, for you in the library, is 7 okay, or is 6 better?
Anytime, because I'm there, so, you know.
Okay.
You can have access to the space whenever.
So we'll have a ZBA workshop at 7 at the public library, and who do I need to talk to so that we post it properly?
Caroline.
Caroline?
Or do you do the posting?
I usually do the postings, but, so for this, does it need to be, are we saying that it needs to be noticed in the paper? Or does it just need to be noticed? Yeah, then I can notice it.
Yeah, no, this is not a, let's see, there are the legal notices, and then there's the notice of a public meeting under 91A.
Okay.
That's all this is.
Okay, yeah, I can do that.
It's just a workshop session.
So what I do is, I do the notice, and I send it to you for approval before I send it out. And just put on the email that Tia asked us, just go out through that too. Yeah.
And I, what I'll promise to do in the meantime is I'll look through the OSI manual for the question about membership and planning board membership. I think the one action item there would be to elect a vice chair if I can get that answer by then. Is there any?
You could do that tonight, Charlie.
Pardon?
You could elect a vice chair tonight.
We could, although you had raised the question about whether John could
vote.
Could vote.
Vote. That was all that I raised. Nothing more.
So you think he could be vice chair?
I don't know why he couldn't be anything.
Okay.
But in the past, if we ended up with the wrong number of members showing up,
mm-hmm.
Joe would just say, I'm going to recuse myself. He'd still run the meeting as the chairman,
mm-hmm.
but he didn't vote.
Mm-hmm.
So it all depends on, you know, I mean, people say they're going to show up. As you can see, we already got one missing tonight.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well,
And personally speaking, I think you make a great vice chairman.
Thank you.
How am I doing, John?
He's also vice chairman.
All right. Well, and you have, by virtue of your long tenure on the board, you don't want to be vice chair?
No, thank you.
Okay. Are there other nominations?
I think that would be inappropriate.
I don't know. I think you could be fine. It can be a challenge, but.
Nicely put.
But it's all good.
Thank you, John.
It's all good. Are there any other nominations?
I'd like to second it too.
And you'd like to second it as well.
I ain't letting you walk through them too easy.
Okay. So, I think we have minutes. And as the chair of the meeting, I'll cast a ballot for John Hinsman as the vice chair. And then we'll sort out the question of voting. All right. Is there anything else tonight that we should take up?
So, Sonny, you're proposing a motion to
Yes.
He's vice to Mitt, too.
I think he's nominated him to be vice chair.
Okay.
And I think he already seconded it.
I seconded my own.
Actually, John said he would be willing to be vice chair, so I'm treating that as the nomination. And Sonny said he would second it.
Okay.
That would get complicated to second our motions.
And I think you said you were casting one ballot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Although if people want the chance to vote, I'm happy to hold a vote.
No.
Is there anything else that we should do tonight? This may be the shortest ZBA meeting we ever have, but let's be thankful for that. And so we'll see you on June 4th at 7 p.m. at the Rollinsford Public Library. Denise, thank you very much for chairing our meeting, and we'll adjourn at 7:40.